Hello everyone. I hope your semesters are going well. I wanted to take this opportunity to share some updates with you about three groups that I'm involved in and that all serve in an advisory capacity to the Provost. First, I want to draw your attention to the formation of a trauma-informed practices group. This group is led by faculty and staff members whose work is guided by this approach, whether in the classroom or indeed in supporting students or the university community in other ways. Their work is going to focus on education, including the development of resources and supports for BROC faculty and staff, consultation, including in support of units or programs who wish to avail of advice on procedures or processes through a trauma-informed lens, as well as advocacy in guiding us all towards integrating trauma-informed frameworks across campus. More information about this group will be shared in the coming weeks, including how you may reach out to benefit from their expertise. Second, the Learning Spaces Modernization and Planning Advisory Group. I know that's a mouthful. It advises the Provost on priorities and expenditures related to technology, infrastructure, and standards for learning spaces across the university. And this is within the broader context of policies discussed at Senate's Information Technology and Infrastructure Committee, as well as the Long-Term Capital Plan. This group has been meeting over the past few months and discussing priorities for the next year that will include things like improving accessibility within our learning spaces and evaluating the use of our existing spaces, including innovations that the university is already invested in, such as our high-flex classrooms. And finally, our newly constituted Open Education Working Group has been busy at work and working out the operational details related to BROC's new Open Educational Resources Adoption Grant Program. This was, of course, announced a couple of weeks ago during International Open Education Week. And this new grant program reflects the commitment in our new academic plan to provide supports for the creation, adaptation, and adoption of OER. But it also reflects the growing body of research that demonstrates the positive impact that using OER has on both students and faculty. This includes, for example, greater persistence, equivalent or better course performance, significant cost savings, as well as, of course, more equitable access to students, not to mention greater pedagogical flexibility for faculty. So these new OER adoption grants recognize the labor involved in making the pedagogical adjustments necessary, for example, to replace expensive commercial textbooks with OER, while reaffirming the academic freedom of faculty members to determine what are appropriate required course materials and if OER are indeed a good fit or not. It is worth noting that each of these three advisory groups that I'm talking about connects with specific actions listed in the new academic plan. For example, Action 4D concerns the development of resources and supports for educators grounded in anti-racist and trauma-informed pedagogies. Action 1G concerns the enhancement of our physical as well as our digital learning environments to support the delivery of high-quality educational experiences across all course delivery formats. And of course, Action 2I, as I mentioned, concerns the development of supports for the creation, adaptation, and adoption, in this case, of OER. I mention this because work continues towards the development of implementation plans for each of the 44 actions listed in our new academic plan. This is something that I will bring you regular updates about, including, of course, through the Senate Planning, Priorities, and Budget Advisory Committee. For now, those are my updates, and I wish you a wonderful remainder of the term. Hope to see you on campus soon.